There are moments when historical events seem poised to reveal their full significance. Alexander the Great, at the head of his army, on the verge of taking the vast and inexhaustible Persian Empire. Hannibal preparing to cross the Alps with his elephants to strike at the heart of Rome. Caesar standing on the banks of the Rubicon, and so on. The presentation, which you're about to witness, focuses on an even more important isolated event, which has had a far greater effect than any of the aforementioned historic junctures. That moment involves Napoleon Bonaparte at the height of his adoration by the French people, whom he had pulled out of an abyss created by years of chaos and misrule. He is on the brink of declaring himself Emperor of France, but we must keep in mind what has led up to this moment. In November 1799, just after returning from his conquest of Egypt, the still young Bonaparte, along with his brother Lucien and confidant Abiesies, triumphed over the head of the Directory, and with that ended the four-year rule of that governing body. After this coup d'etat, a new replacement for the absent government presented itself in the form of a consulate, guided by the terms of a new constitution and led by a triumvirate, consisting of three main consuls. The first consul, Bonaparte, the second consul, Jean-Jacques-Régis de Cambacérès, and the third consul, Charles-François Lebrun. But it was really only the first consul which held the true power. The others were mainly advisors, and they had much to advise upon. At the start of the consulate, France was in quite the perilous state. Business and industry were in shambles. The currency had been devalued by 99%, and there were no taxes, budgets, nor balance sheets. And revolutionary soldiers and government workers complained they were due a year's worth of salary. The country had lost its way and become victim to every form of excess and abuse. And for over 4 years, from the end of 1799 to 1803, Bonaparte worked tirelessly to restore France. By the early months of 1804, Napoleon Bonaparte had nearly fulfilled every promise he had made to his loyal citizens, and was well on his way to re-establishing and exceeding the prestige of the pre-revolutionary France. It must have been around here that he began to consider the idea of becoming an emperor. Therefore, the setting of this drama is a decisive conversation between Bonaparte and Cambacérès during the course of the winter of 1803 to 1804. Every word of Napoleon's part of this conversation, imaginary though it is, was actually said or written by him at one time or another, and taken from contemporary accounts, reports, memoirs, and so on. On the other hand, some liberties have been taken with Cambacérès, for he was a far less significant figure, and what he has to say, therefore, carries less weight. Admittedly, most of it has been made up, but for the purpose of this performance, Bonaparte must have someone to speak to. But why Cambacérès? Firstly, he was second consul to Bonaparte's first consul. Each one naturally operates from a very different level of authority, but they were the two most important figures of the consulate, compared to Lebrun, the more austere third consul. Cambacérès, in the eyes of his countrymen, was the very embodiment of the revolutionary tradition. He played an essential role in composing the Napoleonic Code, and as president of the Senate and the Conseil d'État, he was free to exercise full power and diplomacy on Bonaparte's behalf during the emperor's absences on military expeditions. Moreover, Cambacérès was highly intelligent and flexible, as well as politically adept, perhaps a little too adept. Bonaparte was very often surrounded by generals who were constantly at his side on the field of battle. These generals were blindly loyal to him and less at home in the world of language and concepts than they were in the theatre of war. Cambacérès was perhaps the only civil figure in Napoleon's immediate entourage who would engage him in discourse over matters of state. He was also, unlike most others at the time, unafraid to argue with Bonaparte. The obvious next question then becomes, why Bonaparte? Well, the reasons are quite simple. Because he was a genius. Because he was the successor to Achilles, Caesar, and Alexander the Great. Because he changed the course of history, and, in the process, helped shape the world in which we now live. He may have ultimately failed in his empire, but he failed in dazzling fashion, leaving a trail of powder across Europe. And most of all, because his was one of the most extraordinary historic and romantic adventures of all time. Most rulers who left their mark upon their time had inherited power, ascending from the deaths of their fathers, brothers, or uncles. Napoleon Bonaparte was the child of his own achievement. He gave rise to himself. He was a living myth, a self-created legend, a self-made god. He was that rare element found at the source of greatness, whether in politics, art, literature, or science. For his ambitions were transformed into history, and his dreams moved to the point of being realized. That intersection between dream and reality is what this work of fiction attempts to capture. Though fictional it may be, it is not impossible, and not even unreasonable, to imagine that this conversation took place as recounted in the following production. And so now, I take you to Napoleon Bonaparte's residence in the Palais de Tuileries. Sometime around the beginning of the winter of 1803 to 1804, where the second consul has paid a visit for conversation and a match of chess, which is nearly concluded.
What a great error to have even challenged Napoleon Bonaparte to a game of strategy.
Was not so great an error as your last move.
I should leave now. Permit me the honor of offering you my farewell.
Remain with me a little while longer, Citizen Second Consul. I would like a rematch over which I may discuss something of importance with you.
With great pleasure. My time is yours. What is on your mind?
I would like to get your views, my dear colleague, on my current position.
To be honest, Citizen First Consul, you have no reason to be concerned. France adores you, and the glory brought in by the wars in Italy and Egypt have thrilled them, and the peace of Amiens has reassured them. For the first time in years, a sliver of happiness and hope have supplanted anguish, and those outside our borders bend our way and fear you.
Yes, yes, I know all of this. The French love panache and have rediscovered a little of their merriment and carefree cheer. They have shown me devotion, and foreigners do treat me well. Yet to them, nothing about our government seems stable. They do not know where they stand with France. I will tell you something. Nor do I.
I am not accustomed to hearing you sound so uncertain.
It is the nations around us that are uncertain. They are hesitant to ally themselves more closely with me. I can sense their reticence. They do not know what dance step to take with that odd form of government.
Truly.
Truly. The ambiguities of the consulate give them pause.
Nonetheless, they have no choice but to attest to the order and security that now reign in our country. Think on how different things were just 4 years ago.
It was anarchy, disguised as a new revolutionary civil order. 20,000 criminals immersed Paris in the red of fire and blood, and 40,000 royalist counter-revolutionaries had control of the country in the west, intercepting communications between Paris and the sea.
Admiral Bruix told me at the time that it had taken him a month to reach Brest to take up his command.
In 30 of the country's departments, the counter-revolution was little more than a pretext to blatant thievery. The right bank of the Garonne, Provence, the Languedoc, and the entire Garonne Valley were in the hands of highwaymen. Coaches were attacked, couriers robbed, homes looted. Pillagers were putting peasants' feet on red-hot grills to make them tell where they had money stashed.
I know several merchants, even two representatives on official business, who bought passports from these bands just to ensure safe passage from Paris to Marseille or Aix-en-Provence. No one went anywhere without an armed and knowledgeable escort.
Such apprehensions no longer persist, and it is indisputable that that is because of me. It is also indisputable that the present is better than the past, but the future is what preoccupies me now.
Do you not believe you have secured the future because you have done away with the past?
Do not deceive yourself. I am at one with France's past, and several times have I saved it from foreign threat. I have fought against and beaten violence, hatred, excesses, divisions, and factions.
And with that, there was little fight. You and your people have completely removed our previous sovereigns and have put your wife in the bedroom of Marie Antoinette, and you have taken as your bedroom that of Louis XVI. And yet, I understand that you find this a somewhat sad place.
Grandeur is always sad.
You say that only because you arrived to find its walls covered in revolutionary graffiti and festooned by decorations dominated by the red cap.
And no sooner did I order that filth to be removed. Enough of the red heel and the red cap. Enough of the Jacobins and the Royalists. I recognize no more parties and see in France only the French. I have had enough of these people taking sides. I am on the side of the French people, and I leave nothing to chance, neither the great issues or the smallest details. I have taken the place of the Bourbons and embody a sovereign people. I restore order to things. But I do not restore them for others, I restore them for myself. Which is why I founded the constitution which Sieyès had proposed to be so indignant. Do you remember Cambacérès?
Very clearly. Under his layout, at the top there would be a grand elector, a king without royal command installed in Versailles who would choose two consuls, one to manage exterior matters and the other interior. Below them would be the ministers and the procurators of public service, and at their side a college of conservators, who would have designated a tribunal that would debate matters of laws, and a legislative body that would have voted upon them.
Perhaps, then, you remember you were in favor of all that nonsense.
In favor? Permit me to say that that is simplifying it a little. I'd not hesitate to abandon the spirit of assembly for the spirit of government, and choose you over that nonsense, as you put it.
As for me, I would have rather been up to my neck in blood than see any of that become reality. When Sieyès proposed that I move into Versailles and assume the ridiculous title of Grand Elector, which I perceived as meaning a weak-kneed king, I replied, "How is it, Citizen Sieyès, that you would believe a man of honor would agree to be a pig in the manure inside Versailles?"
That shook everyone up. You then rid yourself of Sieyès and Barras, correct? Those two had seemed to be all-powerful, and you recruited me to replace them. For this, I am still inexpressibly grateful.
It is I who should be grateful. You are wise, pragmatic, and prudent. Perhaps too pragmatic and too prudent. Regardless, this is why you're second consul. And above all, you're an excellent administrator. Military men are excellent at slashing and burning, but it is the administrators who determine the success of an enterprise.
I owe you everything. I serve you scrupulously and loyally.
You have yet to disappoint me, and I hold no expectations of disappointment. You have been very useful to me in regards to the territories, the concordant, the civil code, and the Légion d'honneur.
If I have served you well, I have fulfilled my destiny.
Almost nothing was left after 20 years of mediocrity and 10 years of disorder. I wanted to create things that will endure. I dreamed of a Republican knighthood to recognize exactly the kind of distinction treated disdainfully by the monarchy and dragged through the muddy basin by the Jacobins. This is why I instituted the Légion d'honneur. I wanted a body of laws worthy of Moses, of Solomon, and of Justinian. This is why I imposed the civil code, drafted things to you in a style capable of making poets and novelists pale with envy.
How impatient you were during those indeterminable debates on marriage, divorce, natural children, succession, capital punishment. You always wanted to move more quickly, and I was always keen, for your sake, to finding the simplest, briefest, and clearest formulation. All those condemned to death will have their head removed.
But setting up the Concordant was undoubtedly your finest moment. The role of the church is of great national importance. You know as well as I do, Cambacérès, that to sovereigns like us, religion is not about the grand mystery of reincarnation, but instead a means to social order. Society cannot exist without morality, and morality does not exist without religion. Only religion can give the state long and lasting support. A society without religion is like a ship without a compass. I was a Mohammedan in Egypt, and I'll be a Buddhist in India. I'm a Catholic here because most here are Catholic. I place no faith in metaphysical nonsense, and I thumb my nose at holy men. Aside from Talleyrand, of course, who is much different and who keeps the future in mind. Besides this, I've never used bishops in my government. Priests, I've discovered, are as chatty as women. No state secret is kept safe under their robes. Yet, religion is still as necessary to the state as the police or the army. Bells and cannons are the two great voices of men, competing with thunder, that great sound of nature. I made cannons speak in Egypt and in Italy. I mourned the silence of the bells in our campaigns. I remember one Sunday I was at Malmaison. I was walking through the solitude and the silence of nature. Then suddenly, the church bells of Raoul struck my ears. I felt moved. So strong is the power of childhood habit and of upbringing. Then I thought to myself, what an impression this must have on simple, incredulous people. What can your philosophers and ideologists answer to this? The people need religion. Hence my signing of the Concordat. It is a vaccine against religion. In 50 years, there will be no religion in France. But for the time being, and for the sake of the cohesion of society, it became necessary to restore the churches. So I did.
It is like what Voltaire and Robespierre said of the Supreme Being. If it did not exist, it would be necessary to invent it. The singing of the Te Deum hymn at Notre Dame on Easter Sunday had not come from nowhere.
The Jacobins were furious. Even the army balked.
Indeed they did. General Delmas told me, this is a pretty good procession of monks. All it was lacking was the million men that had to kill each other to destroy what Napoleon is effortlessly bringing back today.
Notre Dame had been closed for nearly a decade. My Republican colonels, my Jacobin captains, my 20-year-old lieutenants, none of them had ever been to Mass before. Only Talleyrand.
Do you plan to turn the Catholics of France into Republicans?
No. You forget that I also defended the rights of Protestants and of Jews, but admittedly, I gave most to the church designed to best serve me. I appointed bishops who would obey me and feel honored to dine with the prefect. Priests who were once religious ministers now have become government ministers, and with them come their followers.
Have you yet gained the favor of Chateaubriand?
Regrettably, no. Chateaubriand has talent, but he is impossible. Successful men of letters think themselves the center of the world. My difficulties with Monsieur de Chateaubriand are not whether to buy him or not, but whether or not I should pay him what he believes he is worth. You see, he has offered himself to me more than 20 times, but always in such a way that would make me bend to his imagination, which leads to falseness rather than the other way around. I've always ended up refusing his services, meaning to serve him. I am sorry for this. With Talleyrand, Chateaubriand has the brightest mind of our times. It is regrettable, for his sake, that he does not have a greater sense of his own interests.
And what of your brother Lucien? Where Chateaubriand seems to work hard, but not for your interests, Lucien seems far more devoted to making those interests his own.
Ugh, how I know that Lucien conspires against me. Why do you think I made him ambassador to Spain?
To remove him as Minister of the Interior. And to get him far from Paris. That was well done.
Lucien is ambitious and thinks himself self-made. He badly wants to be involved in politics, and so he plays the part of the Republican, and then pretends to be a part of a patriotism which he mocks in private. Joseph, my older brother, has very little ambition, and also not much spirit. Lucien, on the other hand, could easily see himself sharing in my power. He has helped me achieve this position in some minor ways, but has never stopped conspiring against me with a clumsiness that does us both harm. Yet he keeps doing it, and now he wants to get married.
I thought that he was already married.
He was. He took off to wed the daughter of a Provence innkeeper. She died, which was a good thing, then just as swiftly began pursuing Juliette Recamier, who wanted nothing to do with him. Yet he chose not to desist from sending her ridiculous letters with openings such as, Romeo writes to you, his Juliet.
This came to you through the intel of Fouché, I should imagine?
Of course. Thanks to Fouché, whom, even though he is no longer a minister, though I may reappoint him, I have a functioning police force. But then, I learned from my sister Pauline that Lucien had become infatuated by a widow by the name of Madame Houbethon. I opposed this relationship, but to no effect. Do you know what he said to me?
I'm afraid I do not. I'm not as close to Fouché as you are, and this is the first I have heard of this.
Well, he said to me, at least mine is pretty.
Is he supposing that your Josephine is anything less than the striking beauty she inaugurably is? That is not only vulgar, it's inaccurate. In any case, I hope that he will not marry her. Or let him make her a kept woman. It seems she is accustomed to that, and it is his fantasy.
Too late. He married her. Lucien is as much of an idiot in his private life as in his public life. Oh, my dear colleague, the French people think I am preoccupied only with great thoughts of power and war, and instead I spend my time worrying about petty family quarrels.
I find that hard to believe.
No, it is quite true. My youngest brother Jerome is only 19, but while he was on a trip to the United States, he married an American girl.
An American?
Yes, an American. The daughter of a merchant from the city of Baltimore by the name of Elizabeth Patterson. So, now you see, I am the brother-in-law of Madame Puebethon and Elizabeth Patterson.
Lest we not forget, you are the victor of Rivoli and Marengo. You have conquered Venice and Egypt, you have forced the English to sign a peace treaty, and you are first consul and president of the Italian Republic.
I also have brothers and sisters, and they strive to poison my life and dishonor that which I have taken such pains to nurture. Only my dear and beautiful sister Pauline has given me some satisfaction.
At least there's that.
As you say, after the death of poor Leclerc, who was taken from her by yellow fever in Santo Domingo, she has found consolation. First with that thug Salavés who hated me and whom I got rid of. By then, happily, she married Prince Camille Aldobrandi Borghese, grandnephew of two popes, who's both more capable and wealthy than that miserable Bacchiocchi, husband of my other sister, Elisa.
My congratulations, Citizen First Consul.
Yes, but now we arrive at troubled Elisa. She has gone mad with rage and jealousy. Her relationship with that journalist Fontan is not enough to bring her peace. Oh, Cambacérès, you see how it is with my family? Mine has made disgraceful marriages and yet dreams of wealth and glory. They owe everything to me and yet want everything from me. Power, money, titles, honors. It makes me wonder sometimes whether we are not all sharing in the legacy of my dead father. Everything they have comes from me and I am exhausting myself, counteracting their idiocies and grossness.
You can always count upon your friends. Upon me, who thinks only of your greatness. And upon Josephine.
Josephine, I love her so very much. But now even she has begun making problems for me. Serious problems by not giving me an heir. And the meaningless things with which she harangues me all day long. Have you heard about this business of the shawl?
No. What shawl?
It would appear that about 2 weeks ago, an Armenian merchant called upon my sister Caroline with a cashmere shawl embroidered in red and gold and covered with enormous flowers. A garish thing, but strange and rather extraordinary, and therefore outrageously expensive.
I wonder what price Madame Moreau would consider outrageous.
15,000 francs.
Ah, that is a hefty price.
That too was what Caroline thought. She told the Armenian, "That is much too costly. I will not buy it." Then she added almost immediately after that withdrawal, "My God, but it is handsome. I would offer you 10,000 for it." To which the Armenian replied, 15,000, no less. This angered Caroline, who then stormed all the way home from the market, but not before telling him that he was out of his mind.
To her very great credit.
Yes, but it did not end there. It was not the Armenian, but Caroline who was out of their mind. She dreamed about that shawl. She happened to run into my stepdaughter, Hortense, and went on and on about it. Hortense then went to Josephine, her caring mother, and told her about this alleged wonder of the East. Josephine was seized immediately with the desire to possess it. She moved heaven and earth to find the Armenian merchant and first offered him 12,000, then 13, and finally bought the damn thing for 15,000 francs.
Did you reproach her?
I reproach her nothing, but the story still is not finished. A few days later, Elisa went to have dinner with my wife. The moment Elisa arrived, she saw her sister-in-law was wearing the famous shawl. She had never seen it herself, but Caroline had described it with such emotion in her voice and detail in her description that she recognized it instantaneously. The very next day, she had nothing better to do than to hurry over and inform her sister that she had lost the shawl forever to her sister-in-law. Caroline was furious. She told her husband Moreau that Josephine had only bought it to spite her, and that she would never speak to her again.
Good heavens. I can see how this would be pitiful for any other family, but for yours?
My mother and Joseph's wife went to Josephine and asked if she would be willing to give the shawl to Caroline, thus putting an end to this absurd discord. Josephine replied that it was hers and that she intended to keep it. Voices were raised, tears flowed. Caroline demanded that her sister-in-law give her the shawl for what she paid for it. My wife responded that she would just as soon burn it. My mother, Moreau, my brother Joseph, Elisa, and Hortense were all involved in this battle. The Tuileries had become a hell.
And where did you come down on it all?
Weary of all the fuss and tears and pouting, I decided that Josephine could keep the shawl, but she could never wear it. And in exchange, I gave Caroline a very fine string of pearls. And thus concluded the drama with the timeless and proven combination of women, fashion, jewelry, and diplomacy.
A decision worthy of Solomon.
One that took more pain and effort than negotiating for peace with the Austrians or the English.
All families have their petty squabbles. Dazzled by the greatness that you shine in all corners, yours is more demanding than others. But may I be permitted to offer you a word of advice?
Of course.
Do not allow yourself to get caught up in them.
But my heart is no less soft than that of another man. I am generous with my family, but I also respond to their demands and pleas by means of demands and pleas of my own, when I should be more indifferently authoritarian, an ignorant ascendancy. But make no mistake, I know I have a destiny, and I will not be distracted by such squabbles and whining.
Thank heaven for that. That is the leader the Republic needs.
Checkmate.
Congratulations, you've done it again.
I hope this does not lead you to believe yourself to be a poor player in any way. The struggle I face and overcome, albeit only by the narrowest of margins, is a testament to you proving yourself to be a greater challenge than I have ever known from any other opponent.
I thank you kindly for those words, Citizen First Consul. You honor me by the mere allowance of the opportunity to play you in a game of which I am so unworthy of competing in. I should be so humbled as to even spectate a match led by your strategic mastery, let alone compete against it.
You continue to flatter me and act as if I were the greatest player you know.
You are. Of all the players I have had as an opponent, of all the players I have witnessed in other matches, the master above them all.
You must not be so prolific then. Tell me, have you ever visited the Café de la Régence? It is in Paris along the Rue Saint-Honoré.
No, I cannot say that I have.
Well, it is a coffee house which has for quite some time been known as the center for competitive, dignified chess in Paris, in France, in all of the world.
Oh?
When I was second lieutenant of my artillery regiment, I was periodically stationed in Paris, where I made a point of stopping by this distinguished café. There I saw the legendary François-André Danicon-Philidor play a great many matches against a diverse carousel of competitors, all of which he defeated with remarkable strategy and execution.
Did you play him?
I did not dare. This is the man who had literally written the book on chess, L'Analyse du Jeu d'Échecs. He would play multiple games simultaneously while blindfolded.
Blindfolded, you say?
Yes, and he would win. Unfortunately, his family was in the service of the kings, and so he was forced to flee during the early days of the revolution.
A pity.
Indeed. But as I was saying, it is not I who is a master, but he and countless others like him. I would be but a helpless naif in a round against any of these true masters of the game. They would immediately detect and perceive my weaknesses, and before taking any notice, they would exploit that to my disadvantage and send me off in humiliation.
Weaknesses such as...
Oh, how sly you are. I see what you were doing. Trying to get me to provide you the means to develop a winning strategy against myself.
Yes, but I was not attempting to be covert or secret in that pursuit, which is why you so easily caught on.
I will tell you this, and mind you, it is not common nor favorable for me to expound upon my own shortcomings, especially when I know it is to be used to my disadvantage, but for the sake of the good humor we have entertained this far, and as a favor to you, my trusted friend, I'll provide you with that which you would like to know.
That is not necessary. I feel as if I am being unfair to you.
By no means. It is my wish. And besides, this may make the game a little more balanced. Bring you up to my level, as it were.
Very well.
Above all, first, to better your play, I shall give you some simple, general advice. That you should always think of the game in respect to its whole and in terms of a single move. In every match of chess, as in every battle, there is a moment in which the least maneuver is decisive and gives superiority, as one drop of water may cause an overflow. Now, on the same topic, I turn more specifically to you and your playstyle. You, on several occasions, as I have observed, make ill-conceived moves, and as your next turn, in an attempt to reverse your mistake, move that same piece back to where it previously was. But you are wrong when you believe this corrects a mistake. As a rule, this is to make two mistakes instead of one. Think of it as if it were a march that so happens to be traveling in the wrong direction. It may be believed that a countermarch to return from whence you came and to then properly approach the field of combat is a correction of errors. However, by the time you will have arrived, the enemy will have had time to set up camp, place artillery, load cannons, survey the land, and organize a plan and attack. It would have been much more advantageous to you, when recognizing your mistake, remain where you were and force the enemy to seek you out. This would have then allotted you the time necessary to make all those same preparations they would have made, and you would then have had the clear advantage. This is a principle in which I suggest you adopt for whenever you may make a move you regret and wish to reverse. Keep that piece there where it is and build up your defenses for it, and force your opponent to open himself up if he were to wish to confront that piece.
Your analysis, Citizen First Consul, I must say, is exceptional in every way. Its observation, its diagnosis, and certainly its remedy. I thank you sincerely for this insight.
Your gratitude is premature, for I have not yet concluded this analysis. I have now given you the ability to better your strategy overall by eliminating your major weakness, but I have yet to give you the ability to better your strategy against me through allowing you to recognize my weaknesses.
That is not necessary. With all due respect, you have already given me more than enough.
More than enough to what? To beat me?
Well, no.
Then why do you pass up this opportunity to uncover the key to doing so? You do wish to beat me, correct?
Yes, sir. It would be to me a point of great pride.
And not only me, but others too?
Yes, sir.
Then listen to me and see me as an example for others. By revealing to you my weakness, you should become better trained to find them in whomsoever else you may compete with, without them needing to put it out for you, of course. Now, it is undeniable that man is an animal of attack or of retreat, and that anything in between produces an extreme state of anxiety, no?
You are right, sir.
One of the key realizations which must be made in Master Chess is that there are times when you neither have attacking moves nor defending moves. These moves are known to the Germans as Einschwischenzug. Those are the moves that very often make a difference in great games because one is not being attacked and one also lacks anything to attack. It is a very difficult position, one where a player must wait on the other to make a mistake, all the while making a move that is sound and logical, yet one that truly is not accomplishing a particular goal. This is my weakness, my Achilles heel, so to speak, for though I recognize it and wish very much so to do away with it, I am nonetheless unable to maintain my patience and composure. And if I am to grievously err, this would be when and that would be how. So, now that you've been properly informed and provided with a potentially formidable lead by the provision of this and other insights, what say you to another round?
If you insist.
I do.
I thank you again for your advice, but I must admit I do not think it will be any help to my performance. You already seem to have within your mind a master plan for everything.
I will tell you something I have told no one else. I have never had a master plan for my life. I've always been governed by circumstances. But I've always taken advantage of these circumstances and been their master. Nothing has happened that I did not foresee and seek out, and therefore I'm the only one not to be surprised by what I have accomplished. I can even foresee the future and will get to where I plan to go. Once my political wagon has begun to move, nothing will stop it. And woe to him who falls under its wheels.
And this wagon, where is it headed?
It is about that which I wanted to speak with you, my dear colleague. For the first time in ages, power in France is being wielded by a man who understands the country's needs and who matches what the people want. Order, glory, peace, respect for religion, and the national good. I am that man. Anyone can see what I have accomplished in Italy, in the East, in France. Do you believe that all of this, all that I have done, is purely for the glory of gossips and lawyers? Death means nothing. Living without glory means dying each and every day. Nobody wants to die every day. It is better to live and seek the impossible. Moreover, while it is true that the sun of the dead does not warm their bones, it is equally true that the prospect of immortal glory warms the hearts of the living, and there is no immortality but the memory that is left in the minds of men. The memory I wish to leave behind is that of a man of greater power than I. I am telling you, Cambacérès, I can no longer simply obey. I have tasted command and I cannot now give it up.
3.5 million Frenchmen have chosen to make you consul for life, with the right to freely choose your successor. In the Vendée, the counter-revolutionary capital of France, there were 6 no's and 17,000 yeses. All power now resides with you. What more can you hope for?
I have not forgotten the role you played in the passage of that vote which made me consul for life, and I am grateful to you. You are an invaluable man. Still, what would happen if I were to disappear? That is the question.
Why would you disappear? You are still so young.
True. Though death may be an inevitability, I believe that the bullet that will kill me is yet to be forged. But there had already been several attempts on my life. There will be others, perpetrated likely by either the Jacobins or the Royalists. It is rumored that the Count Artois maintains 60 assassins in Paris, and the madmen of the terror have not yet been disarmed. In the eyes of many, on either side, I am like a dog, and whoever gets to me first can bludgeon me with impunity. 3 years ago, on Christmas evening, on Rue Saint-Quay, just a few steps from your home, I was nearly killed. Before anything had been discovered, I felt that the air was full of daggers, to use Fouché's expression. And had I been killed, it would have taken guts to restore order and pick up the reins of power. And you, my friend, are a little wobbly in the stirrups. I like you a great deal, Commissaries, but you know as well as I that everything rides on me. I founded a new era, now I must make it stick. Dramatic change means nothing unless it lasts. Do you not think we should rise above a regime in which I am only the first magistrate of a republic that's still vulnerable and threatened? As soon as I was installed as consul for life, I saw a throne looming before me. I've spent all my time since then paving the way to it. I was counting on keeping the consulate for 2 years longer, although it is a former government under which there is a hopeless incongruity between facts and phrases. But this conspiracy aimed at upsetting Europe, and so it's become necessary to disillusion Europe and the Jacobins. I accordingly silenced both the Jacobins and the Royalists once and for all. Liberty is but a pretext. Equality is the darling of their hearts. Lo and behold, the people would be so pleased to have a man chosen from the ranks of the army be raised higher than ever.
I knew from the beginning of this conversation that behind it was the end of the Republic. Like you, I have seen for some time, and with justification, that things are tending towards that.
I never doubted it, my friend. You are a man of discernment.
The key is to know when the pear is ripe. If it is, you must not hesitate to pick it. Now, I am certain that your soldiers would share your confidence and follow you into this new era as they would into battle. But are you sure that the rest of the population would as well?
What Renan de Saint-Jean d'Angely wrote the day after the discovery of that conspiracy might have been the cry on the lips of all. They wish to kill Bonaparte. We must protect him and make him immortal.
I too remember such a declaration from my lucky friend. But again, are you sure that others feel the same way? I recall a somewhat opposite reaction from Metgay, who compared it to Julius Caesar, and who called for the birth of thousands of Brutai to stab the tyrant Bonaparte.
Yes, but he is but a lurid pamphleteer and clearly mistaken in denoting Caesar a tyrant. Besides, it is no coincidence that he, one of my few detractors, happened to be implicit in that attempt on my life.
It was never proven that he was one of the plotters.
True, though no direct evidence was ever found, I am certain that he was at the very least an agitator, along with that chemist Chevalier, the amateur bomb maker. Yet, none of that matters anymore. They have all since been executed at the guillotine.
I suppose at that point my question becomes, are you sure that the others who are still left alive will support you? I would presume that your methods of censorship by way of striking off their heads in the twinkling of an eye would leave behind nothing but the most overzealous, fiery adherents.
You may very well mock my actions as unnecessary, but for such an atrocious crime, it was absolutely necessary to have vengeance like a thunderbolt and to shoot as many guilty men as there were victims.
The explosion had not killed even a dozen people, yet you executed 9 men and exiled 130 others.
And if you fail to remember, commissaries, I was not alone in the ordering of their sentences. You, as well as LeBron and I, all issued that consular decree which declared all those suspect of carrying either full or partial responsibility for the terrorist attempt to be placed under special surveillance outside the European territory of the Republic. And furthermore, the Senate ratified this act, certifying that we preserve the Constitution.
You know as well as I do that our docile Senate would never dare oppose you.
Do you believe the Senate was incorrect in its affirmation? Do you believe that our actions were at odds with the Constitution?
Those suspects, and mind you, I say suspects and not convicts, were deported without trial or the right of appeal.
So you do believe it to be unlawful? The aforementioned de Saint-Jean d'Angely, as well as Potali, Tronche, Ruderer, Boula de Mouet, Treha, and a score of others, all lawyers, supported that response, just as they would support me now in my pursuit of my inevitable throne, as countless others would too, to answer your earlier question.
I see. Then the only other question I would ask is this. Do you think that the French are still attached to the idea of a republic, if not only for the sound of its name?
I know the French, and I know even better their flightiness. The ease with which they can change their minds would astound those indecisive royalists who oppose me as much as they try to promote me. The great majority of men attend to what is necessary only when they feel a need for it, the precise time when it is too late. It is for this reason I shall make that change for them. The republic is a false label which the French people are infatuated with the idea of. But this infatuation will pass, just as those previous infatuations have. I am persuaded that in the country's heart lies the willingness for a return to the ways of monarchy.
Yet that word still strikes fear.
My dear colleague, it would not be re-established for the benefit of the Bourbons.
Oh, heaven preserve us from a return of the Bourbons. With all their prejudices, favorites, and faithfully faithless priests, they would immediately make themselves as hated as before.
Yet they themselves do not realize this and dream of nothing but a return to the throne. The pretender, who sometimes calls himself the Count of Lille and other times Louis XVIII, sent me a letter, begging me to save the French people from themselves by means of returning to them their king, such that future nations may bless my memory.
As if you needed to restore the Bourbon yoke to be celebrated by those who will come after you.
My response to him was concise and forthright, consisting but of 5 lines which essentially informed him that he should not dream of returning to his country, nor other equally impossible things. For he would first have to walk across 100,000 dead bodies, winning the unwinnable battle against those Frenchmen who have not any interest in seeing the Bourbons return.
Do you really believe as strongly as you portray that an attempt by the Bourbons to re-enter France will be so effortlessly thwarted?
Of course! They have not a chance in hell.
Does it not still, nonetheless, cause a pinch of fear within you?
I would only feel that pinch of fear you speak of if they actually managed somehow to gain entry to this fortified and loyal republic of mine, an event which, as I have made clear, would never transpire. Anyhow, if this were to happen, you should be more afraid than I at the thought of the restoration, as I remember you voted in favor of the death of the king.
With reservations?
I doubt your reservations will count for much in their eyes. My poor commissaries, I am afraid it is abundantly clear that should the Bourbons ever return, it would be the end of you. There would be nothing neither you nor I could do about it.
Then may they stay where they are, to rid them of any hope of a return, and since you put it that way to give me some sense of peace and security, I am ready to help in the establishment of any royal line other than theirs.
It may surprise you, commissaries, but I do not want to create a royalty like that of the preceding powers.
Why is that?
The other day, one of a throng of courtesans addressed me in language designed for a king. I then informed him that I was first consul of the Republic, and that using or acceding to feudal forms of address was a crime.
But if you do not want to be king, what will become of us?
I understand your concern. You see, no longer is it a matter of saving principles, but of saving people. The era of opinions has been replaced by a new era of interests. You can be sure that I am perfectly able to defend both the people and their interests.
You have already proved as much.
And I will prove it again. Nevertheless, I will never be content merely to substitute one elite for another. After the monarchic heredity and Jacobin egalitarian leveling, I wish for another, better way to select subsequent rulers. And I have found that way, by judging by merit rather than those other qualities. The ideological bases of to each according to his birth and his rank and equality or death will be replaced by to each according to his talents and merit or death. I do not repent the revolution, but I always detested its crimes. I wish to complete the revolution in both senses of the word, both to fulfill it and to bring it to a conclusion. I forbade debauchery and public exposure. I reinstated Carnival and New Year's, ladies-in-waiting, livery, etiquette, breeches, and silk stockings. All the great names, the Perigolds, Brizolts, Rouchefoucauld, Montesquieu, Maille, Segur, and Aubon are my equals. But Moreau, my brother-in-law, was the son of an innkeeper, nay, is the son of a cooper. Augereau was a mason, Lon was a stable boy, Lafibre was a cabinet maker, and his wife was a washerwoman. I want us all to start on a new footing. I would like the world to live in peace, but, and I am not jesting, I would like people to have fun again. I will chase from Tuileries the first man or woman who feels they can make a scene or simply raise their voice. Those who are displeased by some people and who come here each night to express their displeasure have no business here. I have a republican imagination, but a monarchic instinct. I want to establish a republican monarchy, and the republic that is mine is Roman, military, warrior-like and all-conquering. My model is not Versailles. My model is Rome. My model is not the Bourbons. My model is Caesar.
Caesar. This is not the first time this name has been uttered in connection with yourself. Like him, you set a term to the Republic. And like him, you refuse the royal crown.
I do refuse the royal crown, although Talleyrand wants me king. I do not want to be, but I'm not refusing all crowns. I am accustomed to the laurel wreath that the French people gave me after Rivoli, Marengo, and my other victories. But they want to return to monarchy? This does baffle me. But if they express their desire with enough force behind it, then I will assume a title that will strike France and Europe as more solemn, more imposing, and more august than that of king. It will be a new title with ancient roots, that of the Roman Empire and the Holy Roman Empire.
Emperor?
Why not? The Republic would be confided to an emperor. After all, Monsieur de Cambacérès, it is only to royalty that we have all sworn our hatred.
That is true. We have never said a word against an empire.
The title of emperor will not shock republicans and will fully satisfy those inclined to a monarchy. I believe that it would be the best thing to replace what we currently have. I would renounce without any regret the royalty of Hugh Capet and his successors, and I will reconstitute Charlemagne's empire. Rather than succeed to Philippe Auguste or Henry IV or Louis XIV, I will succeed Charlemagne. I will reattach myself to the Holy Roman Empire. I would be Caesar lifted above the king and call myself the supreme leader of Italy, which I am already president of. I would have supremacy over the crown heads and the protectorate over Germany, and would reassume the rights attached to the Western Empire.
It is an idea with powerful appeal. Yet in adopting those forms of Charlemagne's empire as well as that of Rome, what will you do with those forms of the Roman republics already in place, such as the Senate, the tribunals, the quaestors, and the prefects? I have to be honest in saying that I perceive the difficulty in this and feel a sense of unease.
Difficulty? Unease?
Yes. France would accord you the title of emperor, I am sure of it, and with the same enthusiasm that I myself feel. But if you become emperor, citizen, first consul, would you retain the two other consuls? One in charge of finances, meaning Lebrun, and the other running the bureaucracy, meaning, well, myself.
The real difficulty, and actually the scandal of it all, was the existence of three consuls, of which I was, without doubt, the first, but only the first. The title of consul now is nearly as absurd today as the title of director was yesterday. So it will disappear.
Disappear?
Yes, disappear. For you, as for me, the real glory consists of putting oneself above one's state. In peace as in war, I was always above my state. By becoming emperor, I would once more put myself above my state. By fulfilling the prediction made once upon a time by a magician in Martinique that she would someday be more than a queen, I would put Josephine above the state. You as well, I would put above yours. I am a soldier who has made it and who will help you make it too. I have planned for everything. The title of Prince Arch Treasurer will go to Lebrun, and that of Prince Arch Chancellor of the Empire to you, resoundingly replacing the consular titles.
Arch Chancellor? Talleyrand will make fun of me.
No one will make fun of you, nor of me. The French would find it endearingly charming to have their own emperor surrounded by princes. They may laugh the first day, less so the second, and by the third they will be used to it all. Talleyrand will make a few witty remarks of this, I am sure. He will say, look, here the arch-chancellor is arch-riding around his arch-wagon, but this will be short-lived and soon forgotten. And to continue, as for Fouché and the others, I will make him a prince or duke of something. I will pay 100,000 francs per year, and that will take care of it. Let me win a few more battles, and that will take care of everything.
Even the Jacobins?
Well, what caused the revolution?
I am not sure of what you mean.
Vanity. Vanity caused the revolution. And do you know what will bring it to an end?
No, I do not.
Vanity again. It is with rattles that one draws men. They are guided by nothing else than self-interest. That and fear are the only two levers men are moved by. Those who say the contrary are hypocrites. Though young, I am old when it comes to the human heart. If I belong to a party, I am for my party. To an army, for my army. To a state, for my state. The average man only takes his needs into consideration, never his abilities. I wouldn't venture to say this before a tribunal, but between us it can be said.
I am glad that you trust to confide in me.
I have no one else with which to confide. And if I do, they are not so well versed in diplomacy and bureaucracy as you.
My thanks again, Citizen First Consul.
It is nothing. Anyways, I do not see that these past years of revolution have changed the French. They still want glory, distinctions, and rewards. The Jacobins will be given the titles of barons or counts and will go to mass right behind me. Fouché and Talleyrand set an example last year. All of them, even the most rabid among them, will follow suit. However, there are still 12 or 15 metaphysicians who need to be tossed into the water. Vermin caught in my clothes, and it has sometimes been necessary to shoot or deport them. They think that they are a party with all those endless ravings they call oratory. Infernal machines have been set against me. Knives have been sharpened. Impotent plots have been fomented. Add to this list of transgressions, if you will, the sarcasms and the insane notions of these befogged metaphysicians. Against this handful of enemies, I will pit the people of France, and they shall prove to be, in the end, nothing more than simple pests, which I am more than capable of getting rid of. I am not going to allow myself to be attacked like Louis XVI. A revolution can be neither made nor stopped. The only thing that can be done is for one or several of its children to give it direction. And as I am a soldier of destiny, a child of the revolution, and as I come from the people, it was only rational that I should become their leader too. And I will accordingly not permit anyone to insult me like a king, least of all the royalists.
Speaking of them, what shall you do about the royalists?
The royalists will become my problem completely. They will throng around this new Caesar, this Charlemagne reborn, only too happy to retain their old privileges and their new allocations. There will undoubtedly be some foot-draggers, some among them, who are fearful and ashamed. Sooner or later, they will all come around. Many of them are already looking on admiringly. In that distance, from admiration to submission is short. The nobility have been content with the directory and the consulate. It is hard to imagine an empire will not satisfy them. But if they do prove to be rather skittish, and it should become necessary to smite them, then so be it. I will smite them. I will always be careful to balance the Jacobins and the Royalists.
What about the army?
Berthier, Moreau, Massenat, Soult, Lon, Mortier, Ney, Davout, and even Bernadon, whom I do not trust at all, and several others shall be made marshals of the empire. Some among them will be made princes. Moreau, if only to appease my Caroline, may climb higher still.
The church?
The church will always choose a monarchy over a republic, and with good reason. In a republic, it is necessary to please so many and to deceive so many others, and ultimately, the pain exceeds the profit. With a monarchy, the one person it needs to charm in order to remain in power is the leader. The church has only ever revolted against weak princes. I, of course, am not weak, nor a prince. I will be emperor. Moreover, I shall pay the clergy well and include them in the honors list, just as I will give entitlements and honors to anyone who wishes to serve me. And first of all to you, Cambacérès. You shall remain the second most powerful figure in the empire, just as you have been in the consulate.
You have a response for everything. You are not like other men.
I admit that I have done well and made my way handsomely. My approach is nonetheless quite simple. I stay ahead of events, I immerse myself in the details, I leave nothing in the shadows, and above all, I measure my dreams with the calipers of reason, so that I may assure myself that what I have imagined can be translated into reality, and that it may aid me in the purpose and the destiny of my life. You are sometimes mistaken, Cambacérès, and you do lack audacity, but you are also loyal and uncomplicated. While I am with my soldiers on campaign, you will manage the affairs of state. You will gather the ministers, and you will preside over the Senate and State Council, where you will display your greater talent and deeper logic. And you will prove worthy of my confidence.
I hope I have been worthy of it until this moment. Time is short. We have to come up with a coat of arms for the Empire and the Imperial family. Will you take up the escutcheon of your fathers, a golden rake on azure with 3 fleur-de-lis?
No fleur-de-lis. It is an emblem of a banished house and as hated as the white flag. You do not know the power of men's memories. Unfurl a white flag with a fleur-de-lis and half of France will think it means the return of Louis XVIII, to whom today no one gives any thought. I am not the son of Louis XVI, nor even of Louis XIV. I am starting a new dynasty, a new empire, and it will not be that of Hugh Capet. Instead, it will come from me and from antiquity. The things, the words, and the images all shall be different. Fleur-de-lis and white flags belong to the Bourbons. I shall retain the three colors with which we ran them out. Nothing must separate me from France. We must be one and the same.
Would you choose the traditional Gaelic rooster, then? You could set it upon the tricolor flag.
The rooster is reminiscent of the barnyard and not noble enough to incarnate a great nation. What is required is a more powerful beast. Perhaps an elephant, for example. Or a lion crouched upon the map of France, one paw extended along the Rhine with the motto, "He who seeks me, beware."
Is not the Rhine too limiting for your France's ambitions?
You are right. We need not put boundaries on neither our dreams nor our courage. I have a few ideas that are not yet ripe, but they are far-reaching. There is not enough sameness among the nations of Europe, though, to enact such plans. European society needs a regeneration, and there must be a superior power which dominates all the other powers, with enough authority to force them to live in harmony with one another. France is best placed for that purpose, and I for that power. In this world, Europe would be but one province. If we were to make war, it would be the same as making civil war. What does it matter whether two nations are separated by rivers or mountains, or that they speak different idioms? Except for a few shadings, France, Spain, England, Italy, and Germany have the same traditions, the same religion, the same costume. But this is a conversation for another time. Let us return to our search for an emblem and find something better.
What say you to golden bees? They can be found on Chilperic's tombstone.
Bees are a good idea. They could figure on wall hangings, carpets, or mantles. But I am an emperor, and I trace myself back to the Caesars, so I must use their symbols. I choose the eagle. Its wings outspread, bearing lightning in its claws, it will be gold and set upon a field of the noblest color.
Red?
Nay, I feel the blue. My livery shall be green because the Bourbons use blue livery and the heavens should be for everyone. The imperial eagle shall be set upon an azure field, the image of the sky in which he ruled. The eagle shall be my emblem, and it will be indistinguishable from me. My coronation will take place beneath this, my new sign.
Oh yes, a coronation! And so shall the city Cramsby return to its ancient splendor.
If I may ask, why that city before another?
Because it is tradition, an emperor to be anointed. Your coronation could only take place
My coronation will not take place in Cram. One could easily choose the cathedral at St. Peter's in Rome to announce to the world I am to succeed Charlemagne. Still, I have no need of going that far. As the founder of a new empire, I would prefer my coronation to take place in my own capital, and in the noble and ancient cathedral of Notre Dame.
This will be a grand honor for Monseigneur de Valois.
Yet another mistake, Cambacérès. I will not need the services of the Cardinal of Paris.
No need for the Cardinal? So to whom will fall the honor
of... It would not be inappropriate for a Pope to crown an Emperor.
Ah, then take to Rome, will you?
No, Rome will come to Paris.
Pius VII in Paris? That is impossible. Do you not remember Cardinal Caprera and his cross?
Impossible, yes, and yet it will happen. The impossible is not French. The Pope will come to Paris to crown me. He will come, and he will come willingly, because he knows I have the power and wherewithal to reduce him to Bishop of Rome. But instead, I will treat him as if he had an army of 200,000 men behind him. I will immerse him in so many tokens of respect and honor that he will not hesitate to proclaim me God's elected.
Do you really believe the Pope will want to come?
Who could doubt it? We can make the entire College of Cardinals follow him to the end of the earth if it so pleased us.
How? By instilling fear?
No, by appealing to their interest, by dangling before them the riches of the world, which they sometimes seem to prefer over those of heaven. There will be much we could do for religion and the clergy who serve it. Tracts of land and possessions of every kind restored to them, seats in the Senate, a minister dedicated to their needs, convents reopened, altars restored, and beyond that, honors, wealth, credit, and power. Maybe even something greater. Company and conversation with myself, yourself, that of Fouché, the Jacobins, my generals, my soldiers, or whomsoever would please them. The Holy See is a vast empty reservoir of money and ambition. Failing it would be very hard indeed, but possible.
And in exchange for this coronation, what will the Pope receive?
He will receive hope.
I will say it again, you are the most extraordinary of all men. There is not another Frenchman your equal.
Let us dispense with these comparisons to the common man. Firstly, I am Corsican and thus am comparable to the French. Secondly, I sleep more than is rumored. I am a man like others.
Like others?
Yes, but with a greater spirit, a more reliable memory, and a larger capacity to work hard. Imagination rules the world, Cambacérès, and it is my most treasured possession. I cannot see the future any more clearly than you or than any common mortal. I rely upon my unceasing thoughts and memories that are both numerous and specific, and I prepare for it with a great deal of care. I always give myself up entirely to what I undertake. I take my ideas and projects by the neck, the rear, the feet, the head, and I do not stop until I have examined every last inch. Hence, when I have finished considering my project in my head, I think of it as already in motion. I am less moved by the moment of the realization of my designs than by their conception.
Then you are already emperor because you've resolved to be so. You've already been crowned by the Pope. You've been acclaimed by the French people and admired and feared throughout Europe.
I will be. Have no doubt about that. Things will go as I have planned them, event after event. However, this conversation must remain our secret. Act as if it had never taken place. But everything will happen, point by point, just as we have decided.
Does anything unexpected ever happen to you?
Politics. Politics is our modern form of tragedy, replacing the theater for enacting classical fatality. The future belongs to no man. Still, I am trying to bend it to my will. I appear to have a guiding star, and so long as it does not abandon me, I'm called to change the face of the world.
You have already changed France, and I know you will change it yet more. You will change Europe.
I wish only for peace, but if in response to this change, war is forced upon me, I will meet it and win battle after battle. I have already taken Venice, Milan, and Cairo. Italy is mine. Spain, Portugal, and Holland obey me. The Pope would be my vassal, and I will conquer Sicily and Dalmatia. I will make myself the master of the Mediterranean. I will take Vienna, Berlin, Warsaw, and Moscow. I will invade England.
Your eagles will depart and fly across Europe, upon which you will leave your mark.
My dreams go further than solely the borders of Europe. I will triumphantly return to the east, marching on Damascus and Aleppo. I will liberate Syria. I will chase the English out of Levant and threaten them in India. I will overturn the Turk Empire and take Constantinople. And before returning to France, by Adrianople or Vienna, I will level the House of Austria and the Orient and found a great new empire there, which will surely secure my place in history.
As if you have not yet already left a mighty imprint upon the pages of history. You are a magician, conquering not only by military genius but by the power of your words. I listen to you and grow dizzy. You are the author of your own life and set above all other heroes in history, and with a greater ambition than the sum of them all.
If I have any ambition, it is so natural to me, so innate, so intimately linked with my existence, that it is like the blood that circulates in my veins, like the air that I breathe. I never am obliged to fight either against or for ambition, and it is never in a greater hurry than I. It merely keeps pace with the circumstances and my general way of thinking. But I do love pomp, and I will leave nothing to chance. I always do what I say I will do, or die trying. I know how to talk to men.
I was ever a believer in a government by assembly, yet you converted me to believe in a government of one. I was attached to the Republic, and yet you managed to rally me to an empire. This proves that by the power of your words alone, France, which once seemed so great in scale to me, now seems small in comparison to Europe, and Europe itself insignificant in a world dominated by your genius. You are an alchemist who can turn the lower metal of our indecisiveness and uncertainties into pure gold.
It cannot be better phrased, Cambacérès. You have grasped it all, and I congratulate you. The gold will flow in waves upon my dreams and upon those who serve France in my name.
I see a new system rising up out of the ruins of the monarchy and the republic. I salute you, Emperor of the French.
Here's the first time I have been addressed by this title, and I accede to it. I'm glad it comes from you, Jean-Jacques-Régis de Cambacérès. I name you, my cousin, Prince Arch-Chancellor of the Empire, Most Serene Highness, and future Duke of Parma.
Permit me to offer at the feet of your Imperial Majesty the homage of my gratitude and admiration.
Please, please, rise and return to your seat. There's no need for this declaration of gratitude and admiration. You share just as much responsibility in this decision as I. Besides, there's still this neglected chess match to complete.
Maybe I have aided in the promotion of these ideas, but they remain, in the first place, your ideas. And on the topic of this unfinished game, I perhaps wish to imply that it was by design that it be left forgotten, as to save me from the embarrassment I have known from it before.
My Prince Arch-Chancellor, you need never feel embarrassment again. Now, whose turn was it?
I cannot recall.
Then I propose we disregard this game and declare ourselves, each other, and this day a victorious success.
I agree fully with this proposition. Allow me.
So what are your plans for this evening?
I am to dine with Talleyrand, though I do not know if all this waiting has led him to begin eating without me.
Then permit me the honor of asking your company tonight, as I dine shortly.
I would be so delighted.
Have you heard that phrase going around Paris? If you want to eat badly, dine with Lebrun. If you want to eat well, choose Cambacérès.
And if you want to eat fast, dine with Bonaparte. Yes, I have heard it.
That is true. I do eat quickly.
Then let me not keep you much longer. Shall we depart for the dining hall?
You can go ahead without me. I just need a moment more to gather my thoughts.
Understood. I will see you there.
Thus concludes our brief observance of this most important moment in time. Immediately following these events, I presume Napoleon joined Cambacérès for a satisfying dinner, complete with an éclair or gâteau Saint-Honoré as their dessert. Then, later, when the referendum to decide on the implementation of an empire was launched, 3.6 million voters went to the polls, 99% of which supported Napoleon Bonaparte becoming the unchallenged emperor of the French. With this overwhelming backing and the election secured, Napoleon was coronated on the 2nd of December 1804 in the presence of Pope Pius VII in the Cathedral of Notre Dame. Two crowns were brought to the ceremony, a golden laurel wreath recalling the Roman Empire and a replica of the crown of Charlemagne. With this crowning, the empire officially began.